Mira and Harper Audio present A Beginning at the End by Mike Chen, performed by Emily Wu Zeller. Prologue. People were too scared for music tonight. Not that Mojo cared. Her handlers had broken the news about the low attendance nearly an hour ago, with some explanation about how the recent flu epidemic and subsequent rioting and looting kept people at home. They'd served the news with high-end vodka, the good shit imported from Russia, conveniently hidden in a water bottle which she carried from the green room to the stage.
"The show must go on,"
her father proclaimed, like she was doing humanity a service by performing. She suspected his bravado actually stemmed from the fact that her sophomore album's second single had stalled at number 13, a far cry from the lead single's number one debut, or her four straight top five hits off her first album. Either way, the audience, filled with beaming girls a few years younger than herself and their mothers, seemed to agree. Flu or no flu, some people still wanted their songs. Or maybe they just wanted normalcy. So Mojo delivered, perfect note after perfect note, each in time to choreographed dance routines. She even gave her trademark smile. The crowd screamed and sang along, waving their arms to the beat. Halfway through the second song, a peculiar vibe grabbed the audience. Usually a handful of parents disappeared into their phones, especially as the flu scare had heightened over the past week. This time, nearly every adult in the arena was looking at their phone. In the front row, Mojo saw lines of concern on each face. Before the song even finished, some parents grabbed their children and left, pushing through the arena's floor seats and funneling to the exit door. Mojo pushed on, just like she'd always promised her dad. She practically heard his voice over the backup music blasting in her in-ear monitors.
"There is no sophomore slump. Smile."
Between the second and third songs, she gave her customary,
"Thank you,"
and fake talk about how great it was to be wherever they were. New York City, this time, at Madison Square Garden. A girl of 19 embarking on a tour bigger, more ambitious than she could have ever dreamed, and taking the pop world by storm. And yet, she knew nothing real about New York City. She'd never left her hotel room without chaperones and handlers. Not under her dad's watch. One long swig of vodka later, and a warmth rushed to her face, so much so that she wondered if it melted her face paint off. She looked off at the side stage, past the elaborate video set and cadre of backup dancers. But where was the gaffer? Why wasn't anyone at the soundboard? The fourth song had a violin section, yet the contracted violinist wasn't in her spot. Panic raced through Mojo's veins, mental checklists of her marks, all trailed by echoes from her dad's lectures about accountability. Her feet were planted exactly where they should be, her poise straight and high, her last few notes on key, and her words to the audience cheerful. It couldn't have been something she'd done, could it? No, not her fault this time. Someone else is facing Dad's wrath tonight, she thought. The next song's opening electronic beats kicked in. Eyes closed, head tilted back, and arms up, her voice pushed out the song's highest note, despite the fuzziness of the vodka making the vibrato a little harder to sustain. For a few seconds, nothing existed except the sound of her voice and the music behind it. No handlers, no tour, no audience, no record company, no father telling her the next way she'd earn the family fortune. And it almost made the whole thing worth it. Her eyes opened, body coiled for the middle eights dance routine, but the brightness of the house lights threw her off the beat. The drummer and keyboard player stopped, though the pre-recorded backing track continued for a few more seconds before leaving an echo chamber. No applause. No eyes looked Moto's way. Only random yelling and an undecipherable buzzsaw of backstage clamor from her in-ear monitors. She stood, frozen, unable to tell if this was from laced vodka or if it was actually unfolding. People, adults and children, parents and daughters, scrambling to the exits, climbing over chairs and tripping on stairs. Ushers pushing back at the masses before some turned and ran as well. Someone grabbed her shoulder and jerked back, hard.
"We have to go,"
said the voice behind her. "What's going on?" she asked, allowing the hands to push her toward the stage exit. Stephen, her huge 40-something bodyguard, took her by the arm and helped her down the short staircase to the backstage area.
"The flu spread,"
he said.
"A government quarantine. There's some sort of lockdown on travel. The busing starts tonight. First come, first serve. I think everyone's trying to get home or get there. I can't reach your father. Cell phones are jammed up."
They worked their way through the concrete hallways and industrial lighting of the backstage area, people crossing in a mad scramble left and right. Mojo clutched onto her bottle of vodka, both hands to her chest as Stephen ushered her onward. People collapsed in front of her, crying, tripping on their own anxieties, and Stephen shoved her around them, apologizing all the way. Something draped over her shoulders, and it took her a moment to realize that he'd put a thick parka around her. She chuckled at the thought of her sparkly halter top and leather pants wrapped in a down parka that smelled like B.O., but Stephen kept pushing her forward, forward, forward until they hit a set of double doors. The doors flew open, but rather than the arena's quiet loading area from a few hours ago, Mojo saw a thick wall of people, all ages and all colors in a current of movement, pushing back and forth.
"I've got your dad on the line,"
Stephen yelled over the din.
"His car is that way. He wants to get to the airport now. Same thing's happening back home."
His arms stretched out over her head.
"That way, go."
They moved as a pair. Stephen yelling,
"Excuse me!"
over and over until the crowd became too dense to overcome. In front of her, a woman with wisps of gray woven into black hair trembled on her knees. Even with the racket around them, Mojo heard her cry.
"This is the end. This is the end."
The end. People had been making cracks about the end of the world since the flu changed from online rumors to this big thing that everyone talked about all the time. But she'd always figured the end meant a giant pit opening, Satan ushering everyone down a staircase to hell. Not stuck outside Madison Square Garden.
"Hey!"
Stephen yelled, arms spread out to clear a path through the traffic jam of bodies.
"This way!"
Mojo looked at the sobbing woman in front of her, then at Stephen. Somewhere farther down the road, her father sat in a car and waited. She could feel his pull, an invisible tether that never let her get too far away.
"The end, the end,"
the sobbing woman repeated, pausing Mojo in her tracks. But where to go? Every direction just pointed at more chaos. People scrambling with a panic that had overtaken everyone in the loading dock. Possibly the neighborhood. Possibly all New York City. Possibly even the world. And it wasn't just about a flu. It was everything. But maybe that was good. No more tours. No more studio sessions. No more threats about financial security. No more lawyer meetings. No more searches through her luggage. No more worrying about hitting every mark. In the studio. On stage. In life. All of that was done. The very thought caused Mojo to smirk. If this was the end, then she was going out on her own terms. "Stephen!" she yelled. He turned and met her gaze. She twisted the cap off the water-turned vodka bottle, then took most of it down in one long gulp. She poured the remainder on her face paint, a star around her left eye, then wiped it off with her sleeve. The empty bottle flew through the air, probably hitting some poor bloke in the head.
"Tell my dad,"
she said, trying extra hard to pronounce the words with the clear British diction she was raised with.
"To go fuck himself."
For an instant, she caught Stephen's wide-mouthed look, a mix of fear and confusion and disappointment on his face, as though her words crushed his worldview more than the madness around them. But Mojo wouldn't let herself revel in her first, possibly only victory over her father. She ducked and turned quickly. Parka pulled over her head, crushing the product-molded spikes in her hair. Each step pushing forward, shoulders and arms bumping into her as her eyes locked onto the ground, one step at a time. Left, right, left, then right, all as fast as she could go. Screams and car horns and smashing glass building in a wave of desperation around her. Maybe it was the end. But even though her head was down, she walked with dignity for the first time in years. Perhaps ever.
6 years later. Excerpt from the Post-MGS Resource Report, as commissioned by Acting President Tanya Hirsch. Ultimately, the commission came to the following conclusions. Potential for water, energy, communication, and infrastructure distribution were nearly half of pre-outbreak levels. Offers of support from former tech sector leaders can support infrastructure logistics with tools for automation and management. Farming should be migrated to local population centers. Widespread manufacturing will take at least a decade to restart, but unopened goods of all kinds can be recovered, centralized, and distributed by federal convoys. With a roughly 70% reduction in the American population due to the MGS pandemic, these resources remain widely available, and harnessing them creates new jobs for an economic reset. The Commission believes that the largest risk to stability in government-supported metropolitan zones is so-called postapocalyptic stress disorder, PAST, and the way it destabilizes families, the building block of society. It is the Commission's recommendation that all possible initiatives be focused on restoring the nuclear family unit, regardless of gender or sexual orientation, as well as the stability found in blood relations. Children, ultimately, our society's future. State and local municipalities should be given discretion in managing these situations as needed to ensure federal resources maintain focus on larger-scale infrastructure, as well as coordination with international governments for project preservation. Part 1. Strangers. Chapter 1. Rob. President Hirsch to address first fatality in new flu epidemic. Rob Donnelly sneezed as he considered the latest headline out of the Miami Metro. In surrounding cubicles, keyboards paused and conversations hesitated. It wasn't a giant interruption. Work didn't grind to a halt. The San Francisco Metro's local area network didn't fall apart, and no one headed for the exits. But inside the office of Podstar Technologies, that single sneeze was a subtle bump in the road to the workday, and Rob heard the hum of a portable air sanitizer startup. If he stood up and looked around, he probably would see the purple glow from the device's germ-killing UV light. People weren't going to like headlines about flu deaths. Was it providing facts or feeding paranoia? Rob opted for the former, hitting the approve button despite his initial hesitation. Protests explode outside CDC's Atlanta headquarters. Valid news, but maybe too much? The directive in the months since the Greenwood incident was to lay off anything that might induce fear or trigger symptoms of post-apocalyptic stress disorder. While Podstar maintained the region's spotty network, that also meant culling the news for public consumption due to limited public bandwidth. Which meant Rob became the filter for the San Francisco Metro to the world. Looter gang raids government trucks leaving distribution center. Violence involved with that one, so pass. Father offers reward for missing pre-end-of-the-world pop star Mojo. Mojo? That pop star that his wife, Elena, had loved before quarantine? Rob shuddered as one of her songs instantly got stuck in his head. Elena would have laughed at him for that. And the fact that their daughter, Sunny, still listened to Mojo.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.